What's up, Chicago? It's your man, Maze Jackson, about to get ready to go live. You see the intern in the background. We are headed into the studio. It's the Maze Jackson. It's the Maze Jackson Show live on WVON tonight from 9 to midnight. You ready? We about to rock it. So we going in the studio. We about to kick the door in. We doing our thing. Ladies and gentlemen, our chat daddy, he got the studio rocking full of the beautiful ladies.
Got it.
You see Mallory, celebrity photographer of the stars. Say what's up to the people, our chat daddy.
Hey, y'all, look, Maze Jackson is coming up next. You know he's going to have a lot of hot topics tonight. He's a great host, and our chat daddy Sims loves you guys, and these are the wives. These women were amazing
the
tonight.
Wives.
The wives.
I was check it out. What's up?
Let's
say our names. Go ahead for the camera.
I'm Joy Worthy Johnson.
I'm Delisa New Williams.
I am Lynn Sharif.
I am Kristen R. Harris.
And we are the wives.
Hello, do y'all got a reality show coming out or something?
We got something coming for
you. I heard that. Yeah, that's dope. All right. Gentlemen, you know what? Chat Daddy keeps it rocking. We about to do our thing. Getting it cracking. I love that song too. And yeah, so ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM, and I am live in the studio about to get it cracking. Man. Woo! All right, y'all, tune in. Trust. I need y'all to do me a favor, take a moment, share the broadcast, share the broadcast, and share the broadcast. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and then I'm coming Thursday for a clip.
Oh,
all right, y'all. What's up, babe? What's up, Jonathan Todd? All right, y'all, what's up? It's your man, Maze Jackson. Rick, what's up with my mic and my sound for my broadcast? What's up with the mic for the broadcast?
What's up with the sound?
The mic. Come on, man. All right, y'all. What's up? How y'all doing? Do me a favor. Take a moment. Share the broadcast. It's your man, Maze Jackson. So we're going to do 17, 30, 47, and okay. Yeah. I'm one here, and I'm two for these.
I'm trying to get you.
And with the mic in there, with the tripods.
So, okay.
Do you hear wake up everybody in there?
No.
What do you hear?
I hear what you're hearing right there.
Since I fell for you?
Yeah. All right, y'all, hold on. Bear with us. We about to get it rocking in a second.
You don't hear Wake Up Everybody?
Nope, I hear Rated T for Teens.
You're supposed to be hearing Wake Up Everybody. Why are you not hearing Wake Up Everybody? Why are you not hearing Wake Up Everybody?
There it is, I hear it.
You hear it?
I hear it in this one. I got it in this one. We got it in both. I'm good. Thinking ahead. But that's him.
Huh?
That's him.
No, it's coming.
It
should be coming from
over here. There's so much hatred, war, and poverty. Y'all take a moment, share this broadcast. To teach a new way. Maybe they'll be listening to what you have to say. You can hear me? I can't hear you. I'm not lying. Okay. The world won't get no better. Better. We gotta change it, yeah. You and me. The world won't get no better if we just let it be. Na 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 na. The world won't get no better. What's up, Chicago? What's up, Chicago? It's your man, Maze Jackson. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM, and you are rocking with me live. You're going to have to bear with me. I'm flying a little solo because I can't hear myself, but we doing our thing. We are tuned. So if you are tuned in, we got it rocking. We are here in the studio live right now, and I'm telling you, we're going to have a great show. We got a lot going on, Chicago. We got a lot going on. Check it out. So, you know, it's been an active day in the activist community in the world. Facebook really... We got to start taking a look at this Facebook Live and this Facebook stuff because we got to... really start making sure that we are in the right space, the right time. You know, it's a lot going on if you was watching social media this week, and your man Maze Jackson was watching and listening and a lot going on. So let me start here by saying I want to ask Chicago if we can take a 24-hour chill on social media. Man, I'm getting texts. My phone is blowing up. Things are, people are sending me messages, and it's going a little crazy out here. And I just want to ask if we could take a moment to just take a chill. Just everybody cool out for a minute. Stop. Think, and let's reset. Let's not let this social media thing take us further from our mission instead of bringing us closer to our mission. We got an action-packed show for you. Ladies and gentlemen, you're going to have to bear with me for a minute because I'm working. I'm flying a little solo, and I want you to just hang in there with me. We got a great show for you. We have live on the live line. We are going to be talking to Michael Romaine, but I got to get some... It's these right here. I got to be able to hear him before I can take the call. So... bear with us for a second. We're having a couple minutes of difficulties, but we will be here. So right now I want to take a moment and just ask Chicago. I am getting bombarded with Facebook messages, tweets, all types of craziness. And I'm going to ask you all just to stop for a minute and see if there's a way for us to just chill. Let's reset. Let's catch our breath. And let's just take a moment. You know, mental health is an issue that we've got to deal with in our community, and we got to confront it. But I want to make sure that it is not, as we confront these issues, it is not in an effort to attack or destroy, but in an effort to make sure that we are building. I am looking for the opportunity to build, not break. If you are, we really got to start thinking about how we deal and interact with each other. Facebook makes it real easy for us to just hit each other. It makes it very easy for us to hurt each other without really thinking about the impact. So I know it's tempting to share and pass the messages, and woo, it's getting juicy and it's getting salacious, but can we just take 24 hours to chill? Can we take 24 hours to just chill? Now, ladies and gentlemen, we got a great show for you tonight. As soon as we get it worked out, I have got from the editor from the Village Free Press, Mr. Michael Romaine, and we are going to be discussing the What's in It for the Black People Voters Guide, Suburban Edition. We're going to be talking about the Western suburban elections. You know, there's a lot going on out in the Western suburbs, but we need to be informed as we look to make decisions. Now, I'm having some technical difficulties, so I can't get to my caller, Michael Romaine, who is on the live line, so I'm going to ask you all to hold on. Michael, if you can hear me, I'm going to ask you to bear with us as we get this worked out. But ladies and gentlemen, we are going to be discussing the elections in the Western suburbs in the 9 o'clock hour. In the 10 o'clock hour, I don't know if you've seen what's been going on in Oroville. California, where over 200,000 residents have to be evacuated from their homes because the tallest dam in the country has got a hole in it. There's a hole in the dike. Right? There's a hole in the dike. So we are going to be talking to civil engineer Rashad Roderick from the Roderick Group about America's failing infrastructure and what we can do. And is this failing infrastructure an opportunity to rebuild the Black community? And then, in the 11 o'clock hour, we are going to discuss the sanctuary restaurants. Okay? So I've heard of sanctuary cities, welcoming states. Well, now we have a group of restaurant owners who are proclaiming a new designation as sanctuary restaurants, where they believe that everyone should have a seat at the table. What they are saying is that fundamentally, no restaurant in the city of Chicago could operate without the benefits of labor from undocumented immigrants. And so we are going to be discussing that. We're going to ask the WVON listeners to give us a call. Give us a call, 773-591-1690. I'm going to ask you to hold your calls right now because I cannot get to them. But when we do, we are going to come back to Michael Romaine. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. We'll be going to break. And when we come back, we'll be continuing our conversation with Michael Romaine from the Village Free Press. It's your man, Mace Jackson. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's your man Mace Jackson. I am back on the air. We are having some technical difficulties. So, Michael Romaine, if you can hear me, I'm going to ask you to hold on. Hold the live line. I am flying solo tonight, but we are talking about the Western suburbs. Elections in the Western suburbs. Now, ladies and gentlemen, there is a changing dynamic that is occurring in the Western suburbs. Actually, there's a changing dynamic that is occurring in the suburbs of Chicago. You know, as the property and Chicago gets higher, as the taxes get higher, and as the rents and as the mortgages increase in price, Black Chicagoans are increasingly leaving the city of Chicago for the suburbs. Now, it seems like there's a reverse migration. As the city of Chicago becomes hot again, young white suburbanites, as they return from college, are returning to the city. And as they return to the city, and as Chicago rapidly becomes a tech hub of America, the prices continue to rise, pushing Black families out of the city and into the surrounding suburbs. Now, if you have been tuned into, if you have been on social media, if you were involved in the last election cycle, you will know that we created the What's in It for the Black People What's in It for the Black People Voters Guide, and it really focused on the elections. But after doing the Voters Guide, the What's in It for the Black People Voters Guide, people, although, and the goal of the What's in It for the Black People Voters Guide was really to target the judges in the wake of the Laquan McDonald murders, in the wake of everything that happened with the Chicago Police Department, I felt that it was disingenuous for Black people to continue voting against their self-interest. So many times we had received sample ballots in the mail. Let me back up. The story is, with it, I got a piece of mail from my local Cook County Democratic Party, and the mail encouraged me to vote for judges that I had been protesting throughout the year. And so as I looked at the ballot, I thought to myself, how many of our people, after marching all through the year, protesting, etc., why in the world would my party recommend for me to vote for people that we were voting for? There were Laquan McDonald judges on the ballot. There were judges that were part of the John Birch prosecution. And so I said to myself, self, it's time for us to do the What's in It for the Black People Voters Guide. So the What's in It for the Black People Voters Guide was birthed. And while it was birthed, the thing that was so important was the fact that the What's in It for the Black People Voters Guide not only just told you who to vote for, but why to vote for them. So while it was long and extensive, many people said that they found it very helpful. So as we proceeded into the election, into the suburban election cycle, my inbox, my Facebook, everywhere I went, people said, Mace, that guide was so helpful because not only did it tell me who, but it told me why. And so I decided to make it, we decided to come up with another What's in It for the Black People Voters Guide. And we're going to do it for every election cycle. So, what we are going to focus on in this election cycle in the What's in It for the Black People Voters Guide are suburban elections that impact Black people. Now, why is this so important? It goes back to what I was originally talking about, which is the fact that Black folks are increasingly moving in to the suburbs. And I don't know how much you know about the history of Black Chicago, but for so many years, Black Chicagoans who lived in the poorest and the most minority communities were oftentimes represented by white leaders. As times changed and blacks began to seek political empowerment within the city, those white aldermen that represented black areas were often displaced. That system moved to the suburbs. And so when you look at the suburbs now, oftentimes suburbs that are heavily populated by black people are often led by white mayors. Now, generally that white mayor has maintained his power through a combination of handing out goodies, knowing institutional power, and co-opting key members of the black community to lock them in. Now, it's politics, don't get me wrong, but as time goes on, and as we increase our numbers and power, it is key that we take our leadership roles and power and no longer just become partners, but drive the situation. So as we take a look at the suburbs and the dynamics that are in the suburbs, we have to start to take into account capitalizing on our numbers, black numbers, and political empowerment. Now, make it very clear. In the very near future, I would guess that just like the city, the Latino population will dominate. But if we do not participate in the cycle and take our time, will we have the time to build the black infrastructure? So what I decided I wanted to do was take a look at these elections from the suburban perspective. Now, many of you, if you have tuned in the past, you've heard me discuss what goes on in the south suburbs. What goes on in the south suburbs, where we are represented, our political power is represented by white leaders who may not always have the best interests of our entire community, but have the best interests of the old establishment. So I think we have got our technical difficulties taken care of. Insane Wayne, can I talk to Michael Romain? Can I get my caller? Michael, are you there? Awesome, awesome. All right, now, you know what? I almost want to get a reset. Can I go to break and when I come back from... Okay, no breaks. All right. So, ladies and gentlemen, Mike, please, please bear with me. So, ladies and gentlemen, if you have been tuned in... Mike, can you turn your radio down in the background? All right, great. All right, you are tuned into the Talk Chicago 1690 AM. It's your man, Maze Jackson. You are tuned into the Maze Jackson Show from 9 to midnight. I have on the live line Mr. Michael Romain. Now, Mike is the editor of the Village Free Press, and Mike really provides some insight and coverage for the western suburbs. Now, Mike, I don't know if you caught what was going on, but I was trying to give the WVON listeners some background on the What's in It for the Black People Voters Guide. We are doing a suburban edition where we want to give black folks who are looking to make some political decisions in their best interests, we want to give them some insight. And so we have a guide that will be coming out next week, but we also wanted to have the conversation live online. So one of my very good friends, Roberto Sepulveda, told me that if I wanted to get the scoop to know what is going on in the western suburbs, that you were the man to talk to. So I want to appreciate you, first of all, for holding on for so long. And then secondly, give us an introduction. I'm sorry. Can I plug this in too? So
that's my audience. That's my value added. That's what I know best.
So Mike, so talk to me about what is going on in the western suburbs, some of the changing dynamics that are happening out there, particularly with the demographics. Where are the black people going? Are they leaving the state? What's going on with the black folks? What do you attribute that to, Mike?
There are a lot of factors to it.
the main factor, number one factor that probably immediately, most immediately comes to mind is the school factor. Quite frankly, people are not confident in the local elementary and high schools that service Maywood and other surrounding areas like Bellwood, Broadview, and Merrill's Park. You can see it in Forest Park, for instance, which is majority white. Nobody sends their kids. You know, very few people in Forest Park send their kids to provide the Math and Science Academy, which is a pretty good school, ranked number one in the Chicago area.
Wait, which school is this?
Proviso Math and Science Academy.
Oh, okay.
Basically, it's elected admission school, ranked number one by Chicago Magazine in the entire Chicagoland area. And, you know, you still have a lot of Forest Park people who will not send their kids even to that school, yet alone Proviso East, which is a non-starter for a lot of people, not just in, you know, Forest Park, but it's even a non-starter for people in Maywood and Bellwood and these other suburbs.
So where do they send them?
Private schools. They send them to private schools, or they send them to, if they can't get their kids into PMSA, they send them, I don't want to out anybody, but if you have to, you do what you got to do to get a kid into a school in another district, you just do it. But, they send them to private schools. So for the most part, what you have is, there's a lot of people in these areas, especially in predominantly black suburbs like Maywood, a lot of well-to-do people, they don't want to send their kids to the area public school. They'll send them to private school, and thus they have to face being double taxed, essentially, because they're paying into the property. They still got to pay property taxes, and those property taxes, for the most part, are going to local schools, but they're not benefiting from the local schools. They're not sending their kids, and then they got to pay that private school tuition. What do? Do you stay, or do you go, to Bolingbrook, where the local public school probably is as good as a private school that you can get out here, or, it's not as the margin isn't as great separating the public and the private school.
So,
in here, if you live in Maywood, you don't have a choice. It's either, you send your kid to a private school, or you live with the reality of having to send your kid to Proviso East High School. I want to say that's a perception, though. That's not necessarily the reality, because there are some changes happening in the both in the elementary and in the high schools that a lot of people, may not necessarily be noticing, but I think need more attention and exposure. The schools are getting better, from my perspective, with the right leadership, and there has been some good leadership changes made at the district level, at the high school district level, and there's been some good administrative changes made that I think are promising.
So, Mike, hold on one second. I'm going to encourage. We got callers. Give us a call, 773-591-1690. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. It's your man, Maze Jackson. I am talking with the editor of the Village Free Press, Mr. Editor Michael Romaine. We're talking about these suburbs in the West, these elections in the Western suburbs. I want to send a special shout out to my man, Roberto Sepulveda. If there is going to be a black and brown coalition, Roberto is going to make it happen. So I want to send him a shout out. Now, if you are living in the Western suburbs, give us a call, 773-591-1690. We have got Michael Romaine on the line. So, Mike, I'm going to jump into a couple questions. I was doing some reading. So talk to me about the climate. What would you say are the most significant elections that are coming up in the Western suburbs? Like, which are the races to watch? I see the races to watch, yeah. Hello? Mike, did I lose you? All right, ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. I am Michael Romaine, are you there?
I'm there, yeah.
Okay, great. Okay, Mike, so can you tell me what is the role? I've been reading, and it seems like there have been a lot of, or not a lot, but there have been some referendums on term limits in the western suburbs. Talk to me about what that's about and what's going on.
Rob, you just had a referendum that was brought basically by, there's been sort of a split between the mayor of Broadview, who is Sherman Jones. He's the first African-American mayor of that town, I believe. He has served for two terms. He won't be allowed to seek a third term because of a referendum that the majority of his board of trustees passed, which is largely considered sort of an opposition party, in opposition to him. They passed this last year that would require mayors to serve no more than two consecutive terms, having him. And so instead of sort of grandfathering him in or make it apply to 2021, they said it has to apply to this election cycle. Therefore, he cannot run.
Now, what do you think the motivation behind that was?
I don't know, and I don't want to.
You don't want to speculate.
Make any presumptions. I don't know, but what I've there was a big battle. There has been a big battle recently. There still is, about a strip club that's looking to locate into Broadview that Mayor Jones was staunchly opposed to. From his perspective, he would tell you probably that the people who passed this referendum and the people who want him out of office, who succeeded in eventually getting rid of him, although he's campaigning this year as a trustee, and somebody, an African-American woman is the head of the ticket that he's on. But he would say that the motivation is these people are, you know, working the bidding of whoever wants to locate this strip club into Broadview. But that's my superficial understanding of it. I've talked to him. I haven't talked to the other side or some of the other trustees who he's in opposition to. So, I would just say, wait for an article to appear about that, perhaps.
Okay. Now where will we find that article? Tell people where they can find you.
So the website is called thevillagefreepress.org. thevillagefreepress.org. I regret that I made it that long.
Ladies, but
that's what it is. And we cover stuff in Maywood, Bellwood, Broadview, and Merrill's Park. You know, we cover politics and economics and all kinds of different stuff.
So, Michael, tell me about Bellwood. Seems to have passed another one of these referendums, these term limit referendums. Now, Bellwood, tell me about Bellwood. It seems like it's a... Tell me about the changing dynamics in Bellwood. It was represented by Mayor Deep...
Well, he's the mayor. From what I understand, will not be running for another term. From what I understand, if given him his, who's an African American, he would, if he wins, his name is Andre Harvey. He's public safety director for Bellwood, and he's a candidate for mayor. He's, from what I understand, he's sort of like the leading candidate. If he wins, he'll be that town's first African American mayor. I think the first black mayor in Bellwood's history. Bellwood's population is predominantly African American, although it doesn't skew as predominant as Maywood does. It has a larger white population than Maywood and maybe some other suburbs and south suburbs do.
So how do you suggest? How would you? So with these changing racial dynamics, how was Pasquale able to hold on to power?
That's a good question. I don't feel like I know enough.
Okay,
that's a great question.
And this is a question, though, that we have to ask. And Mike, I'm gonna jump in right here because I think this is a question, and this is something that we got to talk to the black community about: is how, if we have the actual physical numbers in so many of these western suburban areas, that we are unable to elect a mayor or to elect the first black mayor. And now this new mayor will sanction who the new mayor becomes. Does that leave this new mayor I don't want to call him a puppet, but does it leave him in a compromising situation as it relates to Mayor Pascual?
I'm not sure. I'm not too in tune with Bellwood's political scene as I am Maywood's. But I will tell you, just to speak to that general point, to be quite honest with you, you know, there are some predominantly African American suburbs. There's a large consensus. I think it's sizable among African Americans. And I think this is something that we have to address that we don't address enough, which is that a lot of us don't believe we can govern ourselves. A lot of us, to be quite frank with you, a lot of us attribute the condition of our towns, places like Harvey and places like Maywood, to the fact that the leadership is African American. And I can't tell you how many times I've talked to people who say, you know, we need somebody white in power so they can fix things. That's the sentiment of a lot of African Americans, to be perfectly honest with you. I think it's wrong. I don't think it's correct. But that's what a lot of black people think.
That's funny that you say that, because I actually experienced that right here in Chicago. For years, I represented the 18th Ward, which was created to be a power black ward, was represented for years by a white alderman, and the people loved him, and if a black alderman came up against him, he would whoop him handily. What do you think the issue is with black folks and feeling that we can't self-govern? Or is it that our black folks get in power and then the spigot gets cut off?
I think you have it more correct than the general assumption. I don't think we as African Americans have really grappled with just the extent to which racial, race-based policies like redlining and other race-based policies, the extent to which those both affected our communities, predominantly African American communities, and you know, both affected them then and are affecting them now. Black communities don't decline because African Americans all of a sudden show up in droves. The community, for the most part, has already declined because resources have been taken out of it, and then African Americans have been steered to these under-resourced communities after they've been basically plundered. And resources and house, property taxes and homeowners have left other areas. That's a deliberate, systematic process that is common to a lot of majority African American towns. And when African Americans get in these situations where they constitute the majority and where they constitute the leadership, you start from having your community in 1950 or 60 being at the 5-yard line. You start in 1980, 1990, you know, when black mayor, when Maywood, for instance, got our first mayor, we were then at the 40-yard line. So we were basically driven, you know, that's what we were when black people took over. That's not because black people took over. It's the other way around. You know, we didn't get dragged back or pushed back that far from the goal line because we did it ourselves. There are systems and processes in place that have facilitated pushing us back so far, and that's not our fault. And so I think we have to grapple more with those systemic processes. A lot of African Americans really, you know, we're quicker to blame ourselves for things, and we're quicker to blame leadership, you know, than we are to really grapple with these systemic processes. And, you know, so I think that's...
Yeah, and it seems like it's happening all over. It seems like we are watching white elected officials across the state pull up stakes, right? So you look at, and I think you're seeing the same thing in the western suburbs as you're seeing in the southern suburbs, which is right now, all of the political power and all of the political clout is held in the hands of a white old boy network establishment. And as they either seek to transition out of power, right, or out of power, they want to install a legacy that allows them to still maintain the mechanisms and bleed the towns dry. And I don't think that we have all, you know, I'm seeing this in a variety of situations. And so how do you, Mike, how do you think we interrupt this system? How do we get a hold of these towns and these places where we're moving? And instead of them becoming bombed, I don't want to call them bombed out, but instead of them becoming traps, they become oases for black, upwardly mobile people. You know, there are beautiful houses with lawns and grass, and, you know, why can't these places become meccas of black life and kind of examples? What do you think holds us back there?
Well, you know, the Village Street Press is my side. It's not a job. I do this for free. It's sort of a passion project. I report full-time as an education staff reporter for Wednesday Journal in Oak Park. And from reporting in Oak Park, I've learned the import. I've learned the dynamics of integration and segregation. Oak Park probably has done more than anywhere in the state fighting back the tide of segregation and resegregation that's existed over the last several decades.
Oak Park?
Oak Park, yeah, Oak Park is very, very progressive. But if you live in Oak Park, or if you spend any time in Oak Park, you know the issues in Oak Park, you realize that this very progressive place has an element of regression. The high school, OPRF High School, is, you know, essentially two high schools. One where you see white kids achieving high, going to Ivy League schools. It's one of the best high schools in the country. But if you isolate OPR and you just isolate it by its student demographic, you would get the achievement numbers of provides the least problem. OPRF every single year graduates a significant amount of black kids who just are not performing at grade level. And in some instances, in many instances, are performing well, well below grade level by the time they graduate high school. And this is a town that's tried its darndest to try to integrate. What they've taught me is that if you do not put in place very conscious, deliberate efforts to try to make white people live and stay near African Americans, the natural, the equilibrium, the natural equilibrium is for white people just to not want to be bothered or to not want to live near African Americans. So you'll naturally get this dynamic where you see a lot of African American places, even in Oak Park, pockets of blackness in Oak Park that are just not up to par.
And are they legislated? Are they legislated places? Like, are they focal points when you talk at city council meetings, et cetera?
Well, there are parts of towns where they bore the front end of racial steering, which is basically real estate professionals crowding people away from heavily African American areas, wherever they may be, towards areas where more of their kind live. And I think you see the same. We'll continue to see the same dynamic in places like Maywood. We'll continue to be majority brown and majority black, and have very few resources to depend on if we continue to be segregated. And if Maywood continues to be majority black, majority brown, you know, that's just what happens.
So,
I think what we have to do is start embracing things like in Oak Park, for instance, they instituted a fair housing ordinance that means that things like racial steering and redlining, you know, the housing covenants, they're illegal, but they also are enforceably illegal. So if you get caught doing it, there's something actually happens to you. I think the reverse needs to happen in places like in overwhelmingly African American suburbs like Maywood and Harvey. I think we need to force white people to move into overwhelmingly black and brown neighborhoods to be quick about it. We need to force wealthier people to move where low income.
Force? How do you force them to do that? Isn't it the whole premise to get up and get out? Like, right, is it laws or is it incentive? Right? Because I think if you try to force people where to live, we might run into some issues. Mike.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. But that's to put it very roughly. But I think you have to do it through laws.
Let me do a station ID right here. Ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in to the Talk Chicago, 1690 AM. It's your man, Maze Jackson. I have on the live line Michael Romaine, editor of the Village Free Press, as well as a staff education reporter at the Wednesday Journal. Did I get that right?
At the Wednesday Journal.
Now, Mike, you know what? We got a late start. I don't know how much time you got left. If you can hang with me just a little bit over, I'd love to keep you for just a few more minutes because this is a very interesting conversation. My question real quick for you, though, is who are the biggest players in the western suburbs, that in the areas that you cover, political players? Like, who are the political influencers? Who are the people that are making the decisions? Because it seems to me that there's some interconnectedness out in those areas. And I don't know, why does it seem like you can go to Oak Park, Forest Park, and then get to Maywood and like, bam, it's such a stark difference, but you've got some of the same state representative, same state representation, Senate rep. Like, so how does that all work together?
Yeah, that is interesting. Maywood is a sort of a political base for Proviso Township. Proviso Township is one of the strongest Democratic townships.
Number two.
In the state.
Number two, right after Thornton.
Right, and when you talk about leadership, you automatically start with the committee man or woman, and right, currently that's Karen Yarbrough, the current Cook County Recorder of Deeds. Maywood has been sort of a base, a political base for that position. The previous Cook County Recorder of Deeds and the previous Democratic Proviso Township, you know, powerhouse was Eugene Moore. And he was from Maywood. Maywood's been sort of a base for Democratic politics in Proviso Township for a long time. For instance, the headquarters for the Democratic Party in Proviso Township is in Maywood. So I think when you talk about power players, you have to talk about Karen Yarbrough, who is a power player. You know, her husband was recently the mayor before he was defeated 4 years ago by the current mayor, Edwina Perkins, who is currently installed in the office.
And, who else we got out there?
That's an interesting dynamic. In Merrill's Park, you have Mayor Sapico, Ron Sapico.
Now, what's his role? Because it seems like that's another interesting dynamic where you've got Melrose Park, which seems to have a huge Latino population, and it's still being represented by kind of the old guard. How does that work?
It's interesting because both Merrill's Park, which has a huge Latino population, and Stone Park, it's tiny, but it's like 90-95% Hispanic. Both of them have Italian. The mayor of Stone Park is Italian. Spico was the Italian. They both have huge Hispanic populations, but historically or traditionally they've been sort of marked by these Italian heavy hitters, which traditionally a lot of people sort of connect them to the mob. I don't want to get into that
because you got to start your car tonight.
And plus, I, you know, and, and as I do. And actually, just recently met, you know, Mayor Stonepark. He's a great guy.
Right. Nope, we don't want no problems, Mr. Mayor. No problems.
But yeah, you see this in these areas. In a lot of places in Proviso Township are marked by these ethnic, sort of these ethnic enclaves.
Mike, can I hold you right there? Can I get you to hold?
Absolutely.
Can I get you just for a little while after this break? I know we said we got a late start, but this is a great conversation. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. It's your man, Maze Jackson. You are tuned in to Michael Romaine, editor of the Village Free Press. We're talking Western suburban elections. What's in it for the black people? We'll be right back. Woo, ladies and gentlemen, that was a marathon struggle session if I ever had one in my entire freaking life. Everything wasn't working. All right, I'll be right back.
As authorities figure out how to fix the flooding danger, correspondent Jim Rube.
Massive erosion began on the emergency spillway of the Oroville Dam, about 75 miles north of Sacramento, when officials cut the flow to the main spillway because of erosion there. The emergency evacuation of nearly 200,000 people below the dam was ordered Sunday, and now water official Eric C. says work is underway to try and keep from a catastrophic spillway failure.
It's very dangerous. It's extremely dangerous.
National Guard helicopters are bringing in bags of boulders to try and repair the erosion, and officials don't know when evacuees will be able to return, especially because more rain is on the way. I'm Jim Roop.
The town of Cary, Maine, near the Canadian border, has gotten 30 inches of snow after a blizzard pounded New England. Extreme avalanche warnings have been issued for two trails on Mount Washington in New Hampshire. I'm Ann Cates.
If you have hard water, the limescale not only leaves white spots, it clogs pipes and breaks down appliances, costing you hundreds of dollars in energy and wear. Eliminate limescale and other water issues like brown staining, bad odors, and lead with HydroCare water products available from Wave Home Solutions. Wave's affordable system.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, what's up? It's your man, Maze Jackson. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago. First of all, thank you all for bearing with me. As you can see, we had a rocky start, but this has been a great conversation. I want to take a moment to give some shout-outs to all the people. Can you take a moment, hit that button, and share the broadcast? Thank you to all the new listeners. Mike Romaine is a great guest. Shout out to Steel Running Stovall, Rory, what's up, all the way from Seattle. Candid Conversations, DeWine, I appreciate you. Freddie Baez, my man, appreciate you, broski. Demby, Seattle, I'm growing my numbers in Seattle. Shout out to my beautiful, lovely wife, Commissioner Carrie Steele. I need all of you all to vote for Commissioner Carrie Steele for Metropolitan Water Rec. Y'all know, as I continue to ask what's in it for the black people, some people just might not like it, but she is the only qualified chemist on the spot in the position. So I need y'all to support my lovely wife. All right, let me say what's up to Kristen Dumasani. Kristen, I told you I really love saying your name. Kristen Dumasani, what's up? Shout out to Jay Richmond. I appreciate you. Go Mob to the bros. Shout out to the intelligence group. You know what I'm saying. Y'all better get up with us. You better learn how to get it done. Shout out to the What's In It For The Black People Facebook page, the Maze Jackson page. Shout out to my main homie, DeJuan Russell, and to the homie, Sadiq. Talay, what's up, man? I thank you for joining us. This is the first time. If you out there, what's up? Roberto is the first of all, y'all know how I feel about this black-brown coalition stuff, but if Roberto Sepulveda is in it, I'm down. That's my main man. What up, Everett Myrick? Shout out to the Bolingbrook crew in the building. Did I mention to y'all that Bolingbrook is the number one team in the state? That we are the greatest, the best? That's, you know, they. I ain't gonna even talk about Michael Romaine and these lame proviso. Go Raiders! All right, if you are out there, can you take a moment, share the broadcast? Take a moment, share it with your friends, hit that button. That one right there. Just, oh, see this number right here? It's usually over here, right? So see this number over here? I need y'all to help me get that number up. Can you take a moment and share the broadcast with your friends and family? There it is. See? Right there. I want this number right here to be like 50, right? I need y'all to do y'all thing. All right. Peace out. Boy, y'all. It was crazy trying to get started today. Did y'all see that? I was trying to untangle, get y'all some listenership, the whole you did. All right. All right, and I want to let y'all know we are going to go an extra half hour with Michael Romain because this conversation is rocking. Stay tuned at 11 o'clock, I mean at 10:30, Rashad Roderick from the Roderick Group will be calling in and we'll be talking about the flood in Oroville. That sounds like Gold Rush City to me. All right. Woo, I'm back. Can y'all do me a favor? Can y'all reach up there and share? Yes, we are definitely taking calls, Roberto. We are taking calls. I think we got it on. I see Cell on the line has a comment on the topic, so we were having some technical difficulties. Now, we are going through some station repairs, so if you are trying to watch on, if you are trying to listen on iHeart, you may not be able to get us because they are moving from system to system. But boy, I'm just telling y'all, y'all got a preview of what goes on backstage. Uh-oh. Yeah! Let's do it right. Now I'm ready. Okay, y'all, we're going to start this over again. Let it ride. We're going to do this like... Oh, okay. So, on my screen, it shows up on the other side. So, I need y'all to help me get that number up, please. Please, please, please. 50 shares. Y'all ready? Wake up, everybody. No more sleeping in bed. I would love to come to LA. Happy to. Just let me know. Inbox me. The world has changed so many much. So much hatred, war, and poverty. Oh. Wake up. To what we have to say. Teach them the very best you can. The world won't get no better if we just let it be. Na 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 na. The world won't get no better. We gotta change it, yeah, just you and me. Wake up all the doctors, treat the old people well. Catch all the hair. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. It's your man, Maze Jackson, and we are doing our thing right here live in the studio. I have on the live line Mr. Michael Romain. He is the editor of the Village Free Press. And Michael Romain, first of all, to the WVON listeners, if you were looking on Facebook, I told you that at this hour we were going to have on the live line Rashad Roderick. We're going to talk about the Oroville flood and civil engineering. Can this be an opportunity to rebuild the black community? But we're going to take that at 10:30 because this conversation on the western suburbs is quite interesting. So when we went to break, Mike, you were describing kind of a scenario in which maybe there's some white ethnic populations that have been able to hold on to control of these western suburbs. And there's some changing dynamics. Now, one of the things that I've noticed is that when there seems to be these type of fights, there seems to be money involved. Now, what kind of budgets are we talking about? What kind of budgets and what kind of money is involved in these municipalities that would make people want to fight over them and hold on to them?
Money is interesting because really you have to look outside of the office in a lot of these municipalities. So, for instance, Merrill's Park is traditionally considered, they control so many seats on a District 89 school board. You know, those are Merrill's Park seats.
Now, what schools would be in District 89? Tell me what schools.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So people would understand that for our listeners.
School, elementary schools in Maywood, elementary schools that service population from Maywood, Bellwood, and Broadview, and Merrill's Park.
Now, why is that important? Who cares about school boards? What's the big deal about a school board?
The thing is, you know, you need legal representation to run a school board. The schools need to contract out when their buildings need to be maintained. They need employees. So all of these decisions, you know, are political, highly political, especially in Proviso Township. Whether you're talking about school janitors who, because they want to keep their job, who may be in certain instances pressured to, you know, to go out and canvass for political candidates in order to keep their job, which they got through this political candidate in the first place. You're talking about contracts that go to the construction companies connected to this candidate, or contracts that go to law firms connected to this politician. So traditionally, the politician's function in this context is sort of as a middleman, sort of broker these contracts, to broker these employment situations, and then they get certain services like canvases, and maybe in the worst case scenario, a cut of whatever contract comes in. In any particular case, let me just make that completely clear.
Hey, he wants to start his car, guys. He wants to start his car. Hey, Mike, they're sending me some signals. I got to send you to break. We got a little technical issue we're going to deal with, so hold on right there. We're going to come right back. You are tuned in to the Talk Chicago, 1690 AM. It's your man, Maze Jackson, 773-591-1690. Give us a call. All right, y'all. Y'all, we need y'all to bear with us. We are doing a little technical stuff. We working it out, but we gonna be all right. Oh, ho. Y'all got me. You got the live Maze Jackson. Boy, we are working it out right here in the studio. So, ladies and gentlemen, we went to break. We were talking to Mr. Michael Romaine, editor of the Village Free Press. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we want Mike to be able to start his car. So, Mike, I want you to be able to start your car. I don't want you to have any issues. And hey, to everybody listening, I don't want no problems. I just want to talk about, I don't want no problems. I just want to talk about what is happening out there. We are right now, Mike. Explain, so we have 91... Rodney Alexander just told me that we have about a $91 million operating budget for those three high schools. Is that right? Or does that sound right? Mike, are you there? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, hold on. Mike, if you're there, just hold on a second. We are doing a switch over right now. Ladies and gentlemen, so as we were talking, I'm looking at my Facebook comments. Rodney, I see you out there, brother. I appreciate you. Rodney says that there is a $91 million budget to operate three high schools. $91 million to operate three high schools seems like a huge amount of money. A huge amount of money. And as he implied, is an opportunity to create a patronage army. So what we see is that people are fighting to maintain control of the school board because of the construction contracts, because of the because of the construction contracts, because of the janitorial contracts, etc. All right, I see Mike back. Mike, can you hear me? Hello? All right, ladies and gentlemen, hold on. Michael Romaine will be right back with us. So as we were discussing the western suburbs, if you are tuned in, give us a call, 773-591-1690. If you're on Facebook Live, I want to give you a shout-out. I want to say thank you for tuning in. Let's see, if you're out there, like, you know what? Are you watching on Facebook Live? You can catch us on Facebook Live, www.facebook.com/MazeJack, M-A-Z-J-C. Mike, are you there? All right, Mike, we are doing some switching over, so we got you back. So, Mike, we were talking about the school board and the power that lies within the school board to create a patronage army. So what's odd to me, though, is it seems like that school district encompasses a majority black area, black or brown area, but is controlled by the white suburb in the western end of it. Does that make sense? Is that what's happening?
Between them and the current mayor, but let me just say that Merrill's Park's mayor has a lot of political power, and he has a lot of influence in District 89 in the elementary school. At the District 209 board, at the high school board level, which is what you're talking about, that 90 some odd million budget, sounds right. That is also sort of controlled by various. It's interesting because there was an election a few years ago that was between people from Forest Park, nearby Forest Park. Their kids are in the district to go to these Proviso East and Proviso Math and Science Academy, and they don't because they don't think that it's always been a perception that the schools aren't good enough in Forest Park. So they put together a ticket of a black woman who has been a long-time board member on this high school board, a Hispanic woman, a white person, some three people. They put together a ticket that they felt was in opposition to the dominant machine, which at the time...
Wait, there's a machine in the suburbs? I thought they broke all of this stuff up in Chicago, man. They don't have Shackman out there?
This is their campaign, okay?
Right. Hey, man, we want this brother to be able to start his car. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, we don't want no problems. Go ahead.
Yeah, right. So, well, the campaign rhetoric was this was a political sort of grassroots movement started, you know, among people who were up, you know, in an uprise against the outgoing school board president, Chris Welch. He's a state rep right now for the 7th district, former school board president.
Now he's sponsored.
At the time when this election was held, he was a state rep and he was long gone. Now he would say that, you know, he does not have he doesn't have an iron grip on the school board, doesn't really even think about it very often. So I want to be fair to both sides. These people said that's not the case. You control so many jobs. You control, you know, your law firm. The law firm that he was employed with has financial interests in the district, and you still have an iron grip. So these were the two colliding factions in the last election that was held for the high school board. And this election, you have those similar factions, those similar groups, this grassroots sort of this group that's dominated by people from Forest Park who want to change the high schools dramatically from the bottom up, and people who their opponents might consider to be leftovers, or they might consider to be allied with Chris Welch's so-called regime. This is the rhetoric, the campaign rhetoric that you'll hear this election for this school board and for this, you know, 90-some-odd million dollar control of this, you know, huge, gigantic budget. But to be quite honest with you, to just put everything in a general perspective, because, you know, we can get in the weeds, but to put everything in perspective, this is a board of three schools. They don't have enough, you know, money, to be quite honest, to fund just the general maintenance of the buildings that they have. You know, this is a financially strained district. What meat there is for patronage and what meat there is for contracts, there is that. I'm pretty certain. But relatively speaking, it's not a whole lot of that. But you do have, you know, the same sort of political machinations that you may see in the city of Chicago. Yeah, that they exist in the suburbs. They may exist to a higher frequency than other people may believe, but you know, that's the same type of dynamic that you see at least in this particular suburban races, you know.
Michael, hold on.
One side, you know, the little guy on the other side, is the machine.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are listening to the Talk of Chicago 1690 AM. I have Michael Romain, editor of the Village Free Press, on the live line. I'm going to take this call because this call has been holding on. We're having some troubles with the calls, but I'm going to see if we can get Cell through. Cell, are you there?
Yes.
All right, wonderful. Cell, give us a call. What you got for us?
I was involved in the Austin area. It was my first community organization. Started in 73, the South Austin Realty Association, and we were addressing housing issues in the Austin community. That position as coordinator led to the organization becoming the first area property manager for housing and urban development. And we had an area from Western Avenue to Austin Boulevard, 26th Street to Chicago Avenue. All 1 to 4 unit buildings came under my inventory. And I witnessed Austin deteriorate at such a rapid pace. This was following the 1968 Housing Act that made FHA mortgages available to black people as it had never been availed to them. People rushed in to take advantage of that opportunity and were no more qualified to become homeowners than a lot of the people today who rush into that. But it really contributed to the decay, along with them, many of them not being financially qualified to be a homeowner. They also bought a lot of junk buildings that turned out to be just a nightmare for them trying to maintain them. Well, Oak Park initiated a project where they were not allowing no more than 3 black families to move into 1 block. Black folks were going crazy, screaming about what Oak Park was doing to limit the concentration of black folks coming in and settling in just one area. Quite honestly, I didn't give a damn what Oak Park was doing. I was too busy trying to help us to keep from tearing up Austin, and it was deteriorating at a rapid pace. I then became one of the first 3 NHS directors.
I gotta speed you up, bro. I'm gonna run out of this break.
Well, bottom line here is that I admire what Oak Park has done to maintain itself. They've done some extremely creative social stuff, even investing on the east side of Oak Park as a way of trying to stem the tide. Appreciate what you're talking about.
Thank you, Cell. I appreciate you. Thank you for holding. Mike, so do you think Oak Park is...
I agree with that.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I agree with that. He actually touched on it. I do agree that Oak Park is at the forefront of a lot of race-based policies, policies that explicitly address some of the racial biases that people, you know, homeowners, would-be homeowners, operate under, that work to perpetuate a radical housing segregation, physical, geographic segregation between races, which is a lot of what undergirds the decline in African American communities. When I say white people should be forced to move to black areas, I don't mean that necessarily literally, but you know, the government forces you by means of law. But the bottom line is if black areas black areas continue to be dominated, if
federal policies continue to contribute to the hurting effect, to the segregating of African-American areas, which, for instance, you know, middle-class black people are more likely to live next to very low-income and poor African-Americans than are, you know, low-income white people. That's the extent to which we've been segregated. I even go so far as to say integration never really happened. It's just been a different means of segregation. So we really have to address this segregating effect. Oak Park has done some great things to make sure that Oak Park stays diverse and not just lily white, or like Austin, didn't just decay and become all black, and all black sort of pseudo or faux ghetto, a neo-ghetto. Maywood and Bellwood, places like Harvey, have to implement policies that do the effect. They have to implement policies that entice people of other cultures, ethnicities, races, personal experiences, and income backgrounds to move into their communities. You're not going to necessarily do it with great marketing campaigns or just telling people to do it. There have to be laws and ordinances put in place that have some teeth and that have some effect. And like you said, incentives that say that lure people of different persuasions to mostly African American or brown communities that are dominated by low income people and are dominated by, you know, this type of culture that we live with every day.
So Mike, we are about to wrap up. I've got about 4 minutes. So let me just ask you real quick, Mike. What would you say are the most significant factors that voters, black voters, should be considering as they go into the polling places in the West suburbs as they make their decisions on who they're going to be voting for?
I would say when you're going into the voting booth, think about the candidate who best lays out a particular vision for where you want your town to be 5 or 10 years from now. And if they don't have that vision, force it out of them. You know, question them. Ask them where they see your town being in the future. And ask them, you know, what their plan is for correcting the tide of economic decay and cultural decline and social decline in the community that goes beyond simply spouting slogans. You know, what kind of laws do they advocate? What kind of ordinances would they help push to try to, you know, for instance, to try to give both homeowners of higher incomes incentives to move into town, to try to give businesses, small, medium, and large, incentives to move into town? You know, what laws are they advocating for at the state and national level to try to make it so that, you know, it's harder for, you know, white people or brown, upper class brown and black people to avoid your community? These are, I think, you know, we have to start thinking seriously about the systematic pressures that have led predominantly African American communities to this position, and, you know, that have contributed to our economic decline, and we have to think about how we can reverse that tide. And so you have to merge the big picture with the local, and that's hard to do, but these candidates in these races have to start thinking about that. They really do.
And Mike, I like to tell our listeners too, I got a thing I like to say or ask, and for our black voters, I want them to stay, and it seems like you summarized it. We got to ask what's in it for the black people. These candidates are coming into our communities. They make the decisions that will impact our children and our young people for years to come. When we move into a community, it should not be a reason for disinvestment, but a reason to spur investment. So we've got to be asking these questions, these incentives, these programs, but how and what we're doing, what is in it for the black people? Black folks, if we don't represent our own self-interest, No one else will. Michael Romaine, you got any closing statements before we go?
I'm just reinforcing what you just said. Be specific, and don't let them preach. Because we got too many preachers running for political office. I mean that metaphorically, not literally.
Well, maybe even literally in some cases. Mike, you know what? I am going to, Michael, first of all, thank you very much for taking time out. Roberto, thank you for connecting us. Mike, I'm going to be following up with you because I want to get some more of your insights as we continue to finish the, complete the What's in It for the Black People Voters Guide. So I want to thank you for taking time out today. I appreciate you. And next time I got to get you in the studio because we got to have this live on Facebook.
Absolutely.
All right.
Thanks for inviting me, and I look forward to meeting you in person.
As do I. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned into the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. When we come back, Rashad Roderick, civil engineer, and we're going to be talking about the Oroville Dam evacuations. Residents near California have to evacuate because the biggest dam in the country has got a leak. We'll talk about it when we come back. Give us a call, 773-591-1690.
May marks the end of the centennial celebration of the Great Migration. An era that
all right, ladies and gentlemen, Rodney, I'm sorry I could not get you. These phones and everything is acting crazy, but I need some more information on what's going on in those western suburbs for the What's in It for the Black People Voters Guide. Please feel free to send me some information. If you are in the western suburbs and... I'm sorry. If you are in the western suburbs and you are... Oh, we back. All right. If you are in the western suburbs and you got an election we should be talking about, please give me a call, send me an inbox, let me know what I need to know so I can get it done. I want to make sure I got everybody's insight. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago. I'm getting my groove on. Now, do you live in the area of 87th Street? Where can a brother get a good sandwich? Does anybody know anywhere in the vicinity of WVON where I could get a good sandwich? Because I'm hungry. I'm hungry as a hostage. Hungry as a hostage. All right, ladies and gentlemen, it is Black Restaurant Eats Week. We got to get Touré in here, too, to get our thing cracking. All right, I'll be right back. And as always, May said, Kelly Phillips. Y'all ready to talk about... All right. Have y'all done me a favor? Can y'all take a moment and share the broadcast? Reach over to hit that button. See, Wayne gonna keep playing my song tonight, huh?
Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed.
No more back-thinking, time for thinking ahead. World's changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred,
war and poverty. Whoa! To teach a new way.
Live. Listen.
What's creepy, Kelly?
And the
the very best you can. I need some good food, y'all. If you live in the vicinity of 87, tell me where I can get some. I want a banging sandwich. Something that can just kill. What's up, Chicago? It's your man, Maze Jackson, and I have got my groove. I'm rocking, rolling. We are doing our thing. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago. I'm going to tell you, I had a great, 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 great conversation with Mr. Michael Romaine, the editor of the Village Free Press. I have one call that I'm going to take, and then we are going to jump into this conversation about, I don't know, ladies and gentlemen, have you seen what's going on in Oroville, California, where the dam has broken and the dam has sprung a leak? Is that what they're telling me? The tallest dam in the country has sprung a leak, and now 200,000 people have got to be evacuated. We're going to talk about that when we get talk, and I've got on the line civil engineer Rashad Johnson. But before we go to that, I'm going to take Stacy. I'm going to take your call because you were holding on and you stuck with us. Stacy, how are you this evening?
Hey, I'm good, brother. How you doing?
All right. What you got for me?
Love the show, man.
Thank you, brother.
You know, I was just about to say, you know, you just got to follow the money. If you look at what's going on in Chicago, this is a big thing about, you know, hiring police officers. But at the end of the day, that's giving more other folks jobs. It's not going into the community. That's one thing. That you can spend that same money with all those dollars you're going to spend, and you can throw a YMCA, you can throw a rec centers, all those things, and you will probably end up, as far as to run them, you'll come in much way under budget and have more money to throw into communities. That's one thing. Another thing is, if you notice, now the big topic in around the world is, or around this country is, making sure that Mexicans go back and building walls and things like that. And if you notice, black folks are jumping on that bandwagon for that cause. They jump on the LGBT bandwagon. And you know what? It's always something to keep us from jumping on our own bandwagon and sticking with our own cause. The Black Lives Matter movement was a great movement. I think they should bring up one major thing is, like King did, is the money. And if you notice, no one's talking about Wells Fargo and the way they discriminated on minorities. That's true racism. That's true systematic racism. If I could make you pay 2-3 points on a loan, that's another $80,000 that you're going to pay over the term of that loan. That's $80,000 liquid dollars. But we're not talking about that. You know, that's the things we should be talking about. We don't talk about the Red Line Act, how they are not letting blacks get loans in their own communities. You know, I think that, you know, I understand we want to stop crime, but the way you stop crime is you get somebody a job.
I think
that's what we should be, you know, discussing. You know, that's my statement for today, my little rant, but what do you think about that?
You know what? I think you're right, Stacey. I do think that we need to look at all of those policies and look at the systems that have been put in place that we continue to fall for. But it's not always that what they do to us is what we allow to be done to ourselves. So we've got to keep having the conversations. I appreciate you. Thank you for calling. Ladies and gentlemen, we are now about to talk about something that got me a little nervous. I turned on the TV this morning to watch Good Morning America, and I saw that the tallest dam in the country has sprung a leak. And no sooner did they try to fix the first leak, did they find out it was a second leak. And it got me to wondering, boy, what happened if that happened at the Hoover Dam? What would happen if that happened to other dams around the country? And I started to think to myself, self, isn't all this stuff built around the same time? So could this be happening to us around the country? Can we expect to see things like this? So instead of panicking, I decided that what I was going to do was go through my super duper Rolex, not Rolex, Rodex, Rolodex, not Rolex, Rolodex, to find a civil engineer who might be able to put some of this in perspective. Because when I wake up and I see that they say that this country, that California has to evacuate 200,000 people from a Northern California town because of the leak, I'm starting to get a little nervous. But then, you know me, Mr. What's in it for the black people, I started to say, if this infrastructure is all messed up, is there an opportunity here for black people to rebuild their communities? So I reached out, and I was able to get top civil engineer Rashad Roderick, civil engineer and principal at the Roderick Group, to give us some insight on what's going on. Rashad, are you there?
I'm here. You should be nervous, Maze. You should be nervous.
Rashad. So, Rashad, before we even get into this conversation, tell the listeners who you are and what the heck does a civil engineer do?
Yeah, so we basically, civil engineers are the ones who design and oversee construction of all of the nation's infrastructure. So everything from wastewater, levees, dams, roads, bridges, railroads, ports, I mean, anything that has to do with infrastructure. And infrastructure is how we move things, right? So whether or not it's by rail, by sea, by road, is how things get moved, right? Goods and services are always moved using infrastructure. So civil engineers are the ones that design and oversee construction of infrastructure in America.
All right, so that is an awesome explanation. So explain to me, now I know that you're not, now I don't know how engineering changes from Illinois to California, et cetera. However, help me understand what is going on with this dam and what actually is happening. And can this happen to us somewhere else?
Right. So let's back up for a second. In 2000, so every 4 years, an independent study is done on America's infrastructure. It's a report card. It's by the American Society of Civil Engineers. And in 2013, right, 4 years ago, that means the new one's coming out in 2017, this year. But 2014, America's grade, so to speak, was a D+.
D plus.
For the grade on our infrastructure. Levees in particular, right, which is what happened in levees and dams, which is what happened in California, nationally, is a D-.
Now, you said levees and dams. Is that sort of like Katrina?
Similar. So Katrina was a disaster waiting to happen. I mean, it literally is. Katrina is kind of like, let's assume that we're standing at the ledge of a bowl. Right?
Okay.
All of New Orleans is the inside of that bowl. And we're standing on the ledge that is what we would consider ground level. So New Orleans itself is actually below sea level. So New Orleans in particular had levees all the way around this bowl to stop the sea level from actually getting inside of the bowl. So just like anything else, if water starts to get into a bowl, what happens? It just overflows and floods it like that. That's what happened in New Orleans.
So
so it was a disaster waiting to happen.
So here, what is happening?
So in California, so every state is graded slightly differently. And in 2013, as I was talking about before, the levees in California were a D. What does that mean? That means that 52% of all of the state-regulated dams had an emergency action plan. That means that they know, like, the infrastructure, the government that runs and manages infrastructure, they knew that dams are bad. It's poor, almost failing. There's 678 dams in California alone that have high hazard dams. So even though, I mean, we look around and we say, oh, yeah, everything is okay, our infrastructure has been eroding for years, and everyone knows about it. Let's make it a little more simple and call it Illinois. So Illinois' infrastructure is a C-, which is a little bit better than the D+ that is nationally. But our roads are a D. Our transit is a D. Our waterways are D-, because we don't really have a lot of dams.
I could give it an F based on these potholes, man. I think I done broke how many axles and bent how many rims. Man. So
right. You're
saying in Illinois that we have a C+. So tell me practical applications, and let me back up. Rashad, is it possible that this dam could break and flood this town out? I was reading a report where they said there could be 30-foot high walls of water. That seems like that would be something like Noah's Arkish.
Yeah, so as it pertains to what's happening over on the coast, that's definitely the case. It would be difficult to do on Lake Michigan just because we don't have the same type of weather and meteorological type of events that can happen on a landlocked body of water versus on the coast with an ocean. So ours are a little bit different, but I will tell you that in Illinois, 87% of the dams in Illinois actually have an emergency action plan on them right now. 87%. That means that not almost 9 out of every 10 dams they know is bad. They know in Illinois alone. Now, granted, again, our dams and our levees aren't as critical as they are on the coast, but even then, I mean, if we don't figure out a way to really start to invest in infrastructure, not just in Illinois, not just in California, but across this nation, we're going to have some serious problems. China, for example, they started spending money on their infrastructure, billions of dollars in their infrastructure, 5 or 6 years ago. And as a result now, their infrastructure, which we always think is always so much worse than ours, is to the point where it's significantly better. Because our infrastructure happened in the 50s and the 40s, and nothing else happened. We're just fixing it. We're not doing anything to really spend the money to do it.
So, Rashad, so help me understand that. It seems like this is like common sense stuff. If the roads are messed up, then we can't get to where we need to go. And if the dams break, then people get flooded. I don't understand, Rashad. So what seems to be the hesitation to invest in our infrastructure?
You know, now you ask me for an opinion, and we know what opinions are like, right? but I'll give you mine, and that is they've all figured out a way to politicize something that shouldn't be politicized. At the end of the day, it doesn't matter what side of the aisle you sit on. Everyone uses infrastructure. In fact, every single day, everybody in the world uses some sort of infrastructure. If you don't leave your house and you turn on your television or you turn on your lights, that means that you have used some infrastructure. If you flush your toilet, you have used infrastructure, and yet no one seems to be able to come to grips to do it. So I'm just of the opinion that because it's tied to so many political type things, it's always tied to some other bill or this or that, that everyone wants to make a big deal about it. At the end of the day, we're going to have to figure out how to pay for it. And it's unfortunate, but when you have a society like ours, who is a capitalistic society, and you're going to go and try to pay for things, you're going to have to raise taxes. And no one wants to raise taxes, but again, we're not talking about a tax on a specific point or a specific person or a specific set of people. Every single person uses infrastructure. Every single person. So if anything should be taxed, it's one thing to tax people who just drive or who just do this or who just that. Everyone uses infrastructure, and yet no one seems to want to raise taxes to pay for it, but I think that's the only way to do it.
So we are talking infrastructure. We are talking about the dam. We are talking about America's crumbling infrastructure with civil engineer and owner of the Roderick Group, Rashad Johnson, civil engineer. You know, that sounds like a real smart kind of job. Rashad, what do you have to do to become a civil engineer? Just for grits.
You know, I'd love to tell you that I was overly smart, but I did a bachelor's and master's degree in civil and structural engineering from University of Illinois.
ILL, I-N-I.
That's it. And then I did my master's in business at Notre Dame.
The Irish man.
Go Irish. I gotta say it.
I think the Irish have done well by you, so I'm not going to even hate on that, brother. You are one of the brothers that is making us proud. What is in it for the black people? Ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago 1690 AM. I am talking to Rashad Johnson, civil engineer and owner of the Roderick Group, and we are talking about America's crumbling infrastructure. So, Rashad, one of the things, though, so you know me, Mr. Mays Jackson, what's in it for the black people? I was thinking, could this infrastructure, crumbling infrastructure, be a crisis that could become an opportunity for the black community?
Absolutely.
So, Rashad, explain to me how we can use the crumbling infrastructure of America to help us rebuild the black community?
Great question, May. So here's the thing. Because we've neglected our infrastructure for so long, eventually they're going to have to pump hundreds of millions of dollars, if not trillions of dollars, billions of dollars, to go in and try to fix our infrastructure. In Chicago, or in Illinois in particular, that infrastructure is going to be funded partly by the feds and partly by the state. That's the way infrastructure funding works. The government is going to cut off a piece of pie, give it to the state, and the state's going to have to match that money in order to get some infrastructure money. That's how the vast majority of it is funded in Illinois. Once that happens, there's going to be engineers and architects and construction.
But Rashad, the engineers and architects, we having a problem with people getting through high school and getting quality education. Yeah. So I don't even know if we get that far. Is there a way that this infrastructure rebuild can help maybe a lower educate a person that hasn't gone all the way through college?
Yeah, so there's a few different ways. Even though in particular in our industry is architects and engineers, but we employ probably a third of our team that don't have college degrees. For example, if they do any utility locating or if they do any surveying, those are types of careers that you could do still in this infrastructure game that doesn't require a college degree. What it requires is for you to be on time, for you to be the professional, for you to speak well, and those are things, and for you to be consistent. And those are things they don't teach you in school. Those are just things that if you want to work, you can make a good living at. Secondly, I'll tell you, in construction in particular, there's going to be tons of opportunities for people with varying levels of education. The biggest roadblock there is going to be the good old-fashioned unions, and I'm just going to drop that bomb right there for you, May, and let you pick it up and run with it.
Wait. So you said that the biggest problem to this is going to be the unions. Explain that to me, Rashad. I often hear that the unions are an obstacle. When you listen to the unions, we hear that they're fighting to protect workers' rights, etc. But then when I talk to the average black man, we always say that they are the obstacle to progress. So help me understand that unique dynamic.
So your question to me was, what's in it for the black people?
What's in it for the black people? Period.
I'm telling you that the vast majority of construction unions do not have the similar makeup of the city in their union.
But Rashad, I thought that the federal law said that you needed to, because they couldn't pick based on race, you needed to pick based on geographical area. So it seems to me that if you live within a geographical area, that you should be able to get those jobs if they're rebuilding your community. What's the problem?
That would seem to be the case. However, if you drive down any of our communities in our black neighborhoods and you look at construction projects, the vast majority of the people who live in, who are working on those construction projects that are in our neighborhoods do not live in our neighborhoods and do not look like us. So I don't know the answer to that question, but I will tell you that there seems to me like a severe lack of opportunity for African Americans in construction unions in the Chicago and Illinois area.
Well, how come I always seem to see, and I don't want to pitch you against anyone, but it seems to me that doesn't seem to be the same challenge for our Latino brother and sisters?
I would agree.
So, you know, Rashad, one of the things that I seem to see, and maybe you can help me understand how this happens, and maybe you can also explain why it's so important for people like yourself to continue to grow your businesses. Rashad, how come we don't see more black people being able to participate in the unions and to participate in this economic largesse, while it does seem that there is a growing opportunity for Latinos? What do we need to do to take a part of this?
Yeah, so again, good question. So one of my other firms that I own is a firm called Material Service Testing. And it's a materials testing laboratory that tests concrete, asphalt, so any construction materials that happen, we have to test it. And it's in all of my contracts, it says, and in order to do this work for the city, the county, or the state, you have to be a union contractor. So I have no choice. So then when I go to the union and say, hey, union, I am a black man, and I've had this conversation with my union where I've told them I want a black steward. And then they come to me and say, well, you know, we have lots of minorities, and I, you know, corrected them and said, that's great. I didn't ask you about minorities. I asked you for a black steward. They don't have anybody to pick from. So of thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people in the Chicago area, fact is the vast majority of people who are in these unions don't look like us.
So my question is, though, because, see, Rashad, this thing gets back to the what's in it for the black people. Why is it then that we are always fighting to protect? It seems to me that black people are caught in between a rock and a hard place, because the base of the Democratic Party tends to be the support from the unions. So the support of the unions is what funds the Democratic politicians, who then, after they fund us, fund our politicians, then they don't hire us in their unions.
Well, it seems like a circle jerk. So let me address that. So there's multiple different types of unions.
Exactly.
The construction unions in particular have a problem with diversity. I'll tell you that the service workers union or the teachers union or some of the other unions probably don't have that same problem. So I think it would be disingenuous of us to put all of the unions in one big basket.
Oh, you know what, right? Rashad, I would first of all like to thank you for that, because I do want to send a shout out to the service unions, the government unions, et cetera, because they have been the path to black middle class success for
Absolutely.
So many people. So let's make sure that I want to make sure that I'm clear that we are not denigrating that group. But let's also talk about the union members that voted for Donald Trump.
There were quite a few of them. My mother was in the teachers union. My father was in the postal workers union. So unions, you're exactly right, paid for middle class education for us. But construction unions in Chicago in 2017 don't look very different than they did in 1975. That's the problem. There's going to be trillions of dollars spent on our infrastructure because we have no choice, because our bridges are falling, our dams are falling apart, and when they pump this trillions of dollars in there, we as black folk need to be in the position to take advantage, and one of the ways to do that is to force these unions to be more inclusive of African Americans and letting them into our...
But Rashad, when you say force them, how can we force them when they fund our elected officials? I mean, what tool do we have to, so if we know that the unions systematically exclude black people, but they spend the money to ensure that they elect our elected officials, which then puts their agenda to the front of the line, even as black unemployment in Illinois is the highest in the country, how do we shake this? How do we break it?
If I had that answer, I probably would be in the White House instead of, what do they call him, Agent Orange?
Agent Orange. Well, Rashad, I think that there's going to be some interesting times ahead, and I think that black people have to be prepared to start receiving some of the benefits that I think we are, that the world hopes that don't happen. I'm not going to say I am a supporter of Agent Orange. What I am is a supporter of the economic opportunities that I believe could be on the horizon as we invest back in America. I think that the key is going to be, are black people prepared to take advantage of the opportunities, or will we allow ourselves to cut our nose off to spite our face? Rashad, first of all, I want to thank you for being with us. You've got a minute if you want to give us a closing, any closing statement.
You know, again, I just want to say that Chicago is made up of 45% African Americans, and yet the amount of infrastructure contracts that go to African American owned firms is less than 2%. That's a problem. When we have a black caucus that is the largest caucus in the city of Chicago, and yet less than 2% of infrastructure contracts go to African American owned firms, that's a problem for me when we have 45% of the population. Number one. Number two is, is that people who own businesses have much more of a tendency to hire people that look like themselves. So if we want to have more African Americans in construction and in engineering, we have to support those black-owned businesses because we are the ones.
Got to cut you right there.
That look like us.
You are tuned into the Talk Chicago 1690 AM. It's your man Maze Jackson. When we come back, Sanctuary Restaurants. You know I'm already hot as it goes. We'll be right back.
Design. And was not expecting to be fired, but obviously the day's events have caught up with them. The weight of this scandal was enough to force him out of this period.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago. I hope y'all enjoyed that conversation. I know it wasn't as sexy as everybody thinks, but we're going to be talking about these Sanctuary Restaurants when we come back. We got to figure this out, y'all. We're going to get in this, what, in this battle. It's got to be a negotiated entry. I'll be right back. Y'all ready? Wait till I come back. Hey, Rashad, thank you for the opportunity to share this conversation. I think, you know, we have to inform and educate our listeners. So thank you, brother. Go on home. Get you some rest. All right, who's out there? Can y'all take a moment, share the broadcast? I'm trying to get them numbers up right there. Go on ahead. Tell your friends. Don't tune out. Tune back in. All right, let's see who we got out here right now. All right. To all the people, if you out there and you still rock with me, I want to say thank you. Shout out to Africa, to my beautiful wife, Commissioner Steele. What's up, Marcus Graham, Jay Richmond, Rodney Alexander, Tim Williams. What's up, Tim Mountain Thornton, Marcus King, Dion Walker. What's up, Bolingbrook to the World Blow Up, Kim Ballwell. What's up, Jim from Elgin. What's up, Sly? What's up, my king loves me, Collins, Roberto Sepulveda, what's up, Dewan Russell, Althea Conyers, what's up, Althea, Jeffrey Farrell, Freddie Baez, what's up, bro, what's up with my drink? Oh, let's see who else we got out there. Darren Hammond, thank you very much. Hold on. Sly. All right. Althea, Jeffrey Farrell, thank you. Freddie, I'm still looking for my drink, man. Heather, what's up, Heather? What up? Craig Nash, Sam Smith. What's up, Lynette Warbington? What's up, little sis? Hope you had a good time. Karen Thompson, Lori Wilcox, Christine Griffith, Kelly Williams, Jeremiah Franklin, Sean Jackson, Ralph O'Donnellson. What's up, Tahani? Darren Hammond, Talay Thompson. Talay, I'd love to come out and speak to your group. Cappuccine Cheeks, Chanel Romaine, Regina Pons, and Ronetta DeWitt Hall. Hope everybody is having a great time. Thank you for rocking with me tonight. Can y'all take a moment, reach over there, hit that button, share the broadcast, share. Y'all ready? Get ready.
Daryl McKissick is the president and CEO of McKissick & McKissick, a national architectural engineering and construction service.
Hey, man, I know y'all got to go to sleep. Y'all got to go to work tomorrow, but wake up!
I'm working very, very hard. It takes a lot of energy to break a glass ceiling.
In addition, she credits her staff.
We've got great people here that are technically capable, but also
humble. Have y'all taken a moment to share the broadcast? Can you just put it on your friend's page so when they wake up in the morning it'll be there? Can you just share it? Can this be the last thing you do before you go to bed tonight? I want to go home and see 1,000 views. 50 shares. What's up? Can a brother get some love? McKissick and McKissick was ranked by Engineering News Record as one of the top 100 construction. I'm about to rock out this 12 o'clock junk, boy. Think it's big stuff coming up. Beautiful. Ooh, ooh. Y'all like my shirt? Look at my pocket. It's a little off. Did you know this shirt also has pockets? How cool is that, right? Like I need some love handles. Thank you, Rodney, for staying with me, brother. Shout out to Jay. I appreciate you. Oh, Michael Flynn resigned. Trump connection to Russia about to be exposed. Will there be an I'm telling y'all don't want Mike Pence. Jay, but I'm watching. Y'all keep me up to date. TV ain't working today. Thanks, babe. I hope you enjoyed the discussion on infrastructure. We need more infrastructure money so that our pipes don't have lead in them. Y'all ready?
The talk of Chicago is 1690.
Thank you, Tamika, for sharing. More I'm gonna try to stop me. It's gonna be some dreadhead niggas in your lobby. You don't want no problem, want no problem with me. Damn. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. It's your man, Mace Jackson. You are rocking with me, and you don't want no problems with me. Y'all, how many of y'all watched Chance last night? Was y'all proud of the young brother? I was proud of the young brother. Hey, man, what's with Chicago rappers and the Jesus thing? We have brought the Lord to the stage one more time. I'm going to say that some of the most groundbreaking artists in history come from Chicago. I mean, seriously. I know y'all hate on Ye. But Kanye, for real, iconic. And now, Chance the Rapper is approaching icon status at 23. Shout out to, did y'all see that Chance and Governor Rauner had a Twitter conversation? It appears that Governor Rauner, when he reached out to congratulate Chance, set up a meeting. Boy, that Governor Rauner, I'm going to tell y'all better watch out. I think they got some stuff up their sleeve. We're going to have to keep an eye on that guy. So Chance the Rapper and Governor Rauner are planning on meeting later on this week. Shout out to Ken Bennett and his wife for investing in their children's dreams. I will be honest with you. You know, when your kid comes home and tells you they want to be a rapper, how many people say, yeah, go with that? Or do they say, man, you better get you a job? So I want to send an extra special shout out to Ken Bennett and his wife for believing. You know, a very a Chicago political legend shared with me his philosophy in life and his philosophy on why he was successful in life. Now, you know, this guy was kind of a political legend. Some of you may know him, some of you may not. Father of Mike and Kevin Joyce, Jeremiah Joyce, once shared with me that he said, "Maze, my only goal in life is to ensure that my children can do whatever they can imagine. That whatever their dream is in life, all I want to do is be able to provide them that. If my kid decides they want to be an actor, I want to give them the best tools to be an actor. If they decide they want to be whatever they want, I want to do it." And so I want to commend Kim Bennett and his wife for rolling with their son and standing with him all the way to this level of success. And I hope that they will have years and many, many more years. I was just going to say, Chance was on the Grammys last night looking like his daddy. Ken, I know you should be proud. We are happy for you, man. All of Black Chicago is rooting for you. And keep on representing for us. Shout out to Ken Bennett. Go back way, way back in the day on the political side. Ken! Back in the day when I was on the dark side. I think we were working together on Lisa Madigan's campaign. How about that? Imagine that. Boy, how far time flies. You probably wouldn't catch me doing that these days, but no disrespect to... Well, we just gonna let that be. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you are into the 11 o'clock hour, and this is the time when I like to spend time with the listeners, and I just like to do a little freestyling, talk about little things that are going on. So, you all are out there tuned in on Facebook Live. I want to appreciate you. Give me a shout out. Make sure you take a moment, share the broadcast, www.facebook.com/MazeJack, MazeJac. You can get me on Twitter, at MazeJack, MazeJac, and on the gram, MazeJack1. Got a moment? Share the broadcast. If you're out there watching us live, if you're still awake, we want to acknowledge and show you some love. For those of y'all that are still watching, right, I want to say thank you very much. Thank you very much to my beautiful wife, Commissioner Carrie Steele, Everett Myrick. I see you out there, brother. What's up, Alvin Norton? Kelly Phillips. Hey, I appreciate all of you all for rocking with me this evening. So, apparently, we've had a resignation. What's going on? Donald Trump is hitting the skids again. Do y'all think Donald Trump is going to make it? I'm curious to know. WVON listeners, how many of you all think that Donald Trump is going to make it through the entire term without being impeached? Give me a call, 773-591-1690. Apparently, let's see. Apparently, Jay Richmond is telling me that Michael Flynn has resigned. General Michael Flynn has resigned for his contact with Russia. If you do not remember General Flynn, he was the one at the Republican convention, that said, lock her up. Lock her up. Well, apparently, he's not that far from getting locked up himself. Q, I see you out there, brother. I'm going to hold that conversation for another day, but it will be happening. Trust me when I tell you. So, Q, I said today we're going to put on a 24-hour chill, right? We're going to take 24 hours just to take a social media break on all of this stuff that's going on with Chicago activism. I'm going to come back. Don't you worry. I'm going to address it, but we got to get it together. So I want to talk about it. So today, you all know how I am with this Donald Trumpness. You know, I think some people may have it confused. They may think that I am a supporter of Donald Trump. That, my friend, is not the case. But what I am is hopeful that the policies that are meant to impact Americans, of which I consider myself, will be a springboard to returning Black folks to a stable situation. Now, don't get me twisted. I'm clear about white supremacy. I understand Steve Bannon. But Black folks, I don't think that the target of this new racism is Black people. I've been pretty clear about that. Now, do I believe that we should participate in the denigration of any of our people? No, I do not. black, brown, Asian, white, Latino. But I also am a proponent of waiting before we get in this fight to make sure that our interests are secured. And so as I have been highlighting this situation, many, many, many people have taken offense. They've been ticked off. I mean, I've been called. I've got some of the most interesting conversation discussions around the immigrant rights issue. Right. So you can imagine how I felt when I woke up this morning to read DNA info, only to find out that there is a new movement. Now, I've heard of the Sanctuary City. I'm not a fan, as you can probably guess. I've heard of the Welcoming State. You're really not a fan. Last week, we had State Representative Chris Welch from the Western Suburbs who talked about creating safe zones for our immigrant population. Still not a proponent. So you can imagine my surprise when I opened up my Facebook to see that Jerry's, the local pizzeria, was the latest to join the Sanctuary Restaurant Movement. The Sanctuary Restaurant Movement, what is the Sanctuary Restaurant Movement? Well, apparently it is a movement in which there is a list of restaurants that has signed on to a list pledging zero tolerance for sexism, racism, and xenophobia among both customers and staff. Let me read that for you one more time. The Sanctuary Restaurant Movement is comprised of a group of restaurants pledging zero tolerance for sexism, racism, and xenophobia. According to Mindy Friedler, co-owner of Jerry's, there probably isn't a restaurant in Chicago that could function without immigrants, both documented and undocumented. If you eat out in Chicago, there's a pretty good chance an immigrant cooked your food, cleaned your tables, washed your dishes, or waited your table, she said. Now, did she just admit that every restaurant in Chicago breaks the law? Think about that. She said that there's no restaurant that we can go in and said legal and undocumented immigrants. Now, let me be clear. If you are in this country legally, I think you should get all the rights and benefits that your visa provides you. But are you trying to tell me black folks can't cook? Are you telling me that black folks can't clean tables, wash dishes, or wait on the table? Maybe I'm crazy, but I thought that's what they brought us here for. That and picking cotton. And so now, what you are telling me is black people are incapable of fulfilling those jobs. Well, let me tell you, folks, as much as people would like to ignore it, I fundamentally believe that there is a direct correlation between the black unemployment rates and the number of undocumented immigrants in our country. So, my question to the WVON listening audience tonight, should we have sanctuary restaurants? Should we protect restaurants? Should we highlight restaurants that have willfully chosen to break the law? I thought that when you got a job, you had to fill out a federal document that proved your status? Was it an I-9? So, fundamentally, what you're saying is we can submit false documents to the government to provide jobs and opportunities, even though we know they're illegal. Even at the same time that we have a 15% unemployment rate among black folks. I just am confused, and I need the WVON listening audience to give me a call and help me understand. Why is it a priority when the black community is being pummeled by unemployment that we have a movement by our restaurants to declare sanctuary restaurants? Who is the leader of the Illinois Restaurant Association or the Chicago Restaurant Association? It seems like as we take on these issues, maybe we should consider these as employment opportunities for the South and West sides of Chicago. When you talk about saying that you want to stop crime and violence, how many times have we heard that the best answer is a job? But yet and still, we have our papers publishing that we cannot survive in this country without undocumented immigrants. Not legally here, for which we have a process. But you mean to tell me that black folks can't cook? What is soul food? Why do people come to the South Side to get soul food? Why are the hot urban restaurants filled with... ladies and gentlemen, I just am lost. I don't think that black people don't want to work in restaurants. We used to work in restaurants. Heck, I used to work in a restaurant. Do y'all understand that my first job was a restaurant? Do you know my dream is to own a restaurant? I know plenty of black people that want to cook. I know plenty of black people that used to wait tables. Shoot, if I could wait tables, you can make hundreds of thousands of dollars. We got callers. James, what you got for me? Give me, what you got, James?
Oh, yeah, well, how you doing, brother?
I'm great, James. How about you?
Man, I'm doing without.
Ooh. What you doing without this time, James?
Yeah, it's always, I ain't got nothing, man. It's getting hard out, champ. Brother's always good to hear you. Now, your guest was talking about the unions. Now, we all know the game of the union. We've been in this city long enough to know that game. I got a cousin. His nephew was in the union in construction or cement work or something. They had him going out to some Elk Grove Village for the classes. Man, that boy got out of that school, finished that mess. Man, they didn't hardly get that boy 2 days of work. And you know you still got to pay your union dues. He had to go find another job. So, you know, that ain't nothing but a game. And if they do get a big contract and redo infrastructure, black people are not going to be there. And we all know that. Now, on sanctuary cities, brother.
We on sanctuary restaurants now, James.
Okay,
restaurants.
Well, restaurants, cities, toilets, whatever, sanctuary. I am a fan of sanctuary cities. I am a fan of whoever can get sanctuary. I don't care if it's a baboon from Mars. Whoever, whatever human can get sanctuary anywhere, I'm for it. And since I can't get it for my people and I can't get it for us, I'm not going to talk against somebody else. Now, you said the target, you don't think the target of white supremacy is black people. Then if the target of white supremacy, Brother Mays, is not black people, what is the target?
James, let me back up. I do believe that ultimately we are the target. They want to destroy melanin. But I'm talking about right now, this issue that we got going on with Donald Trump, I don't think that they are looking to deal with the black issue right now. I think they're looking to deal with the Latino issue.
Okay, you're a smart brother. I'm sure you know what white supremacy is and how it operates. And if you know that, you would know that the white supremacy picks all presidents. Like they picked their Uncle Tom that just left. Had him to do everything they wanted him to do. Cow-tailed him down, scared him, had him scared to fart. So, hey, white supremacy running, Maze. You know that. So, hey, all this mess you got going with Donald Hitler, Barack Bush, George Bushwhacker, they run all them clowns. You know that, Maze. You smart. George Bushwhacker wasn't running nothing. Barack Bush, they made him go bomb people on his last day in office. He couldn't even tell the man, wait a minute, boss, don't make me go bomb nobody on my last day. He went bomb people on his last day in office. Now, he's somewhere having fun, man. We still catching hell of him. People still getting bombed in Afghanistan and the Middle East, man. It's white supremacy, Brother Mays. They run it, brother. I always advise people, if you can get your hat, I advise you to get it. If you want to try to save some grandchild life or some young child life, you got to try to get them out of him. Because our time is up, brother.
Thank you, James. I appreciate
you. Thank you, brother.
All right. Anthony, what you got for me?
Lady, how you doing?
I'm great, Anthony. How about you? Where you calling me from, man?
That's Englewood.
Englewood. Come on, give it to me. What you got for me?
All right, well, you remember they were sitting around here making a big deal about trying to give all workers at least $15 an hour.
Right.
Okay. You got a lot of those Hispanics, they'll work for $5, $6 an hour, and they ain't going to complain. I mean, you can get three of them for $15 an hour.
You know what? See, Anthony, I agree with that. And it's like, when black folks run around here perpetrating that they jobs we don't want to do, do you understand that? Check this out. Anthony, I was talking to somebody today who was on a tirade about black people don't want to do nothing and don't want to work. Anthony, when I was 10 years old, from the ages 10 to 15 until I was able to get a job, I cut grass. And you know how much I cut grass? For between $10 and $12 a lawn. That was in 1985, 86. Do you know that the Latinos will cut your grass for $14 right now?
Yeah.
And so they will cut your whole lawn for $14. Where is the opportunity for the kids? These jobs that they are now saying were for that need to pay a living wage used to be the starter jobs for the kids.
I'm glad you brought that up, a living wage. You know, you can't do a whole lot with $6, $7 an hour.
I agree you can't do much with $6 to $7 an hour. So,
especially if you're an adult with a family.
But again, my question is, why are you working for $6 or $7 an hour as a full-time adult? So I'm not hating.
They're willing to go out and work two, three jobs.
They're willing to work two and three jobs to try and get ahead. And I'm saying that there is somewhere in there's got to be some middle ground. But I know this. I know there's plenty of black people that know how to cook, bus tables, and clean up. And
absolutely.
I'm saying,
we are the best at it.
And if you see...
But nobody wants to work for next to nothing anymore.
Exactly. But I also think, you know what else I think, Anthony, is particularly in the restaurant industry, I think that we have been deceived into not recognizing how much money is really in the restaurant industry. Have you ever noticed that all the servers at the restaurants are young, buffy, white people? Think about this. Do you know that as a waiter in a decent upscale restaurant, you probably making over $100 an hour just in tips? Right? And so I don't think that while you talking about this, even in the restaurant industry, these people aren't making minimum wage. The people that work in the restaurant industry, even the undocumented, are making a killing because they're getting a percentage. But again, it's a secret that is kept from black folks. So they got black folks thinking that you're serving and working for $3 or $2 an hour, when it realistically is it's $2 an hour on the books, but you get a piece of all those tips. Ladies and gentlemen, you are listening to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. We are talking sanctuary restaurants. Is it true that no restaurant in Illinois could operate without the work of undocumented aliens? Apparently, some restaurant owners on the north side think so. What do you think? Give us a call, 773-591-1690. It's your man, Maze Jackson. All right, y'all, tell me. Help me Help me understand. What do we need sanctuary restaurants for? I mean, is there a fear that we're going to run out of help for the restaurants? Are those jobs that black people could get? I'm saying, why is it that it seems to be a priority to employ? Why is it that it seems to be an opportunity, that it's important, more important to employ undocumented aliens than it is to employ people that live here? I just don't understand it. Give us a call, 773-591-1690. We got a half hour left. We'll continue the conversation. It's your man, Maze Jackson. We'll be here.
My elderly mother and her older sister live together.
I'll be right back, y'all.
But could no longer care for themselves independently. I didn't know what to do. Then I discovered South Point Nursing and Rehabilitation Center near Vincennes and 95th Street. South Point can accommodate families who still need to live together. I found a home-like atmosphere that was clean and friendly. They serve great food, even special diets, offer lots of activities, plus church services. There's 24-hour nursing care to monitor my mom's unpredictable diabetes and even restorative rehab to keep them both stronger and mobile. South Point also offers complex medical care as their needs may change. Thank you, South Point, for giving me peace of mind for the two people I love most in this world, my mom and my aunt.
If you want to know more about how South Point can help you or a loved one, call 773-298-1177. That's 773-298-1177 and tour today.
I'm living in that 21st century, doing something mean to it, do it better than anybody you ever seen do it.
Today's society is information overload. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. It's time to get back on message. Time to reconnect to what's important to our community. Here come the commentators with today's message. Here's
check out my commentary, y'all.
The United States has a problem. Because we have people here who do not have any regard for the laws of our country. But imagine if the United States decided to utilize a combination of local law enforcement and federal agents to crack down and get these criminals off the street. And imagine if they used it as an opportunity to rebuild rural communities and increase Wall Street profits. Yes, imagine if the United States created a network of public and private detention facilities that local communities could bid on to regenerate rural economies, employing their people, increasing business, and not to mention local law enforcement increasing tickets and fines to the people that came to visit them. And imagine if instead of educating these prisoners, they were taught skills to make them more profitable to the Wall Street corporations who privately owned and purchased these detention facilities. Sure, some families would be destroyed over nonviolent offenses, but as long as the violence remained contained in those local communities, the country as a whole wouldn't care. Now, I know it sounds wrong, heartless, and cold, but before you get all bent out of shape crying about immigrant rights, that already happened, and it was black people I'm talking about. Now, I know people are really going to hate that I keep talking about this situation, but as always, you can tell them, Macy.
You've been listening to the commentary.
Yeah.
The views expressed are solely
their own. Yeah.
Harry Small.
That is some nonsense.
Hosts the fastest growing radio show in talk radio.
Yeah,
when I was in my 30s, I said, oh, that's for old people. No, WVON is for all people.
Black
people. I've learned so much.
That is so great to
hear.
I got a PhD, okay?
Okay. Harry Small on the Talk of Chicago, WVON.
Yoga. Baby, bend over. Baby, bend over. Baby, bend over. Let me see you do the yoga. Baby, bend over. Baby, bend over. Baby, bend over. Let you are tuned into the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. It's your man, Maze Jackson, and we are on the home stretch. The home stretch. That was Janelle Monae. Y'all know what? That's my jam. That is my jam. And so every time I hear it, it makes me get fired up. That's my morning show, wake up, get it cracking song. That was the inspiration to Black Friday 2 years ago, last year. You are tuned into the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM, Maze Jackson. You are rocking with me. If you're going to make it to midnight, can you hang with me? Can you hang? Chicago, are you... You know, I could do this 9 to midnight a little bit. I like it a little bit. I like talking to y'all. I like rocking with you. Are you watching us on Facebook Live? Are you out there? Let me give a shout out to all the people that are... If you are still rocking with us on Facebook Live, let me get a reaction, and I'm going to give you a shout out while you're out there. I want to say what's up to Thad Slideback. What's up, Charlotte Moore? I see you out there rocking with us. Thanks, Demetrius. I appreciate the love. Dwayne Hurst, Steel Stovall, Antoinette Peterson, thank you very much. What's up to the Silent Assassin? Quavadis, what's up, brother? Appreciate you, QQ. I got your inbox, man. We're going to talk about that a little bit later. What's up, Everett Myrick? Appreciate you. Tim Williams, what's going on? Everybody out there rocking with your man, what's going on? Sean Thomas, appreciate you, brother. All right, before we went to break, I told you I've heard about sanctuary cities. Welcoming states, safe zones, and now we got this new thing, sanctuary restaurants. I'm starting to think this sanctuary thing is the new hot fad. How long before we burn out on sanctuary cities? And where was all these people when it was Laquan? Is it me? I'm sorry. Sanctuary restaurants. So according to the owner of Jerry's Pizzeria, no restaurant in Chicago could operate without the work of undocumented immigrants. Seems like, if I put the what's in it for the black people question to the opportunity if undocumented immigrants were not in the restaurants, would that create more opportunities for black people, or is it that we just don't want to work? I tend to think that black folks could work at restaurants. And if they knew that the money that was being made, whether it be tips, not the $2 an hour they put on the thing, but the tips, I'm here to tell you, I think black folks would take those jobs. But you know, I think it's very convenient for somebody to say black folks don't really want to work, that Latinos do the jobs that black people want. I don't know, man. I'm about tired of that narrative. I'm going to go to Lamont. Lamont, you calling all the way from Texas, man. I know you got some experience. What's going on, brother?
Yeah, you're right. Because them undocumented, they cook everything. Them immigrants is cooking everything. Jamaican food, soul food, every restaurant. I don't care where I go, Chinese. They in every restaurant, yeah, cooking the food. But what I wanted to say is, they also is driving down wages. They driving down wages, and it's illegal. And I'm your friend on Facebook. This is Jacob Israel. We talked about this on your Facebook page. But they are driving down wages. And what if it was the Haitians?
If it was the Haitians, they'd be pushing them back on the boat. They'd be on their way back already. What you talking about?
Who went through hell? Who country is still ravaged? Who country is just tore up? What if they was coming over here? If they was able to make it over here, would they give them sanctuary? Would they be providing them opportunities? Like you said, when you're filling out an application, I thought it was a document. We had to give the truth. I mean, it's like going to lie. It's just like lying. And they said, okay. And you know what? Maze, they'd rather give it to them than us. And they'd rather work around the Mexicans because they don't trust us. They fear us, and they think that we're going to steal all kind of crazy stuff. And it is a lot of, I mean, I got to be honest, too. It's the young people, they don't want to do that kind of work, too. They don't want to do it. Now, there's some older ones that might do it, but overall, they're not young people that's, you know, that's in the streets now, whatever, and they say, okay, yeah, we don't kick all the immigrants out. Y'all come get these jobs. First, they ain't going to want to work around them. Second, they ain't going to want to work. And real quick, on the grand thing, Chance, congratulations, off of 79th Street, Chatham, you know, but he got two last night, but Kanye got 21 Grammys. You understand that? 21 Grammys. Kanye is on a whole, and he was nominated this year. Kanye is on a whole, now, you know, it's going to take Chance another 10 years to try to catch up with Kanye. He was mad at Kanye because he met with Trump, and I was glad he met with Trump. And Chicago need to get it together, and some people from our community need to meet with Trump. They need to get them a school established, get their business, get their plans together, and get some of that bread.
All right.
That's the way I feel.
Lamont, I appreciate you, man. Thank you for calling all the way from Texas, brother. Stick with us, man. Keep watching. Keep listening.
All right.
T, what you got for me?
Man, y'all WVON host becoming a little long-winded. That's on every station, on every host too now, besides a couple of them. Cliff Kelly he's always a consummate gentleman. My point is, before y'all seen all them Mexicans and undocumented workers cooking, fixing y'all polo sausage in Jewtown, that used to be black people. Down at the steakhouses, down at the Palmer and Ronnie Steakhouse, all that used to be black people, Maze. And WVON. I'm a graduate of a fourth-year alumni of Cooking and Hospitality Institute of Chicago, which is now Cordon Bleu. It was over on Chicago and Orleans. And Chicago has always been a sanctuary city for undocumented workers, Maze. It's always been because the white owners prefer low-paying and basically low-paying wages groups, and they are, hello?
I'm here.
Yeah, and they basically, you know, in a way, I ain't gonna say it, though, basically, the Mexicans work very efficiently. They do. And basically, they haven't been, and it's only because they have not been touched with racism and drugs and alcohol and all the stuff that blacks have been touched with. They come from a whole different other culture. Ain't nobody better than us. It's just they haven't been harassed and messed over like us. So Chicago always has been a sanctuary city. It always has been. And Rahm Emanuel's plan is to raise them up, and basically he bypassing us because we moving out of the city.
I think you're right, T. I appreciate you, man. T, I think, T, you've got some valid points. I've said for a long time that Latinos are the new preferred minority, and they are working to the white community is working to push us out, and at the same time, the Latinos are happy to take that spot. However, I do think that this Trump scenario provides at least a little pause for black people, and maybe give us some time to get our act together. You know, you all are blowing me up on Facebook. Jay Richmond, I want to tell you, I appreciate your comments. So Jay says that restaurants choose not to operate without illegal residents. It's not that they can't. They just choose not to because they can get away with not paying, get away with violating the wage laws. Yeah, see, I don't think that, I mean, I think that that was just an indictment on the restaurant industry, where they are basically saying that they are exploiting these people. How many Latino undocumented immigrants are in the fight for 15? And do you think that in the small mom and pop shops that pay cash, do you think that the fight for 15 will impact the immigrant community? No, it will not. Ladies and gentlemen, I mean, black folks, we talking about sanctuary restaurants. Think about this. The gravity of the fact that we have our legitimate restaurant industry telling us that they cannot function legally. with an unemployment rate of 15% in the black community, while we have people flying to Washington, D.C. to talk about protecting sanctuary city statuses and now sanctuary restaurants, we have a 15% unemployment rate with black people. And these people have the audacity to get in the newspaper and tell us that they cannot function without illegal labor. I don't know, does this mean we need to join the fight for 15? I used to say I don't want to pay $20 for a Big Mac, but if it'll get an American working, if it'll get, you know what? They need to put the Calvin commercial back on. Where is McDonald's when you need them? Get the Calvin commercial, and let's see where Calvin is now, because I'm here to tell you. When I was growing up, black people worked. Teenagers were working at McDonald's. You didn't go to McDonald's and it wasn't full-grown people. You might have had two or three, but McDonald's was your after-school job. It wasn't where you made the living. It was the beginning, not the end. And now we are in a race to the bottom as black folks, and now we at the point where the restaurant industry is so willing to protect slave labor wages that they are willing to put a sign in the window. So here's what I want to know. I want to know, for every sanctuary restaurant, can we see an audited payroll? How about that? So if you can't operate your restaurant without the work of undocumented immigrants, we want to see your payroll. Because maybe you shouldn't be in business. If the only way you can operate in business is through being illegal, then maybe you don't have a viable business. Give us a call, 773-591-1690. Should Chicago establish sanctuary restaurants? Why does it seem to me that people outside of the country are more important than the people inside the country? I don't get it. I mean, I think that when we talk about this wages, everybody knows what goes on. We know that these people are not getting paid the right wages. But we accept it. We have liberals crying, oh, they're being deported. But nobody say, oh, the black people are unemployed. We may have found a solution to a bunch of problems if we start honoring the law. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know why it's always legal for black folks, for white folks to pick which laws they gonna honor. But yet and still, we have to. It has been a great evening with you, ladies and gentlemen. What's up? You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago. Are you still rocking with me? If you are, we'd like to let you know you can still catch this on Facebook Live, www.facebook.com/MazeJack, M-A-Z-J-A-C. I would like for you to take a moment and share the broadcast. Share the broadcast. When we come back, we will finish up this conversation. We'll recap everything that has happened, and then we will talk about, we'll be getting ready to talk about tomorrow, because I'll be back with you for the whole rest of the week. So I'm going to be here Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and then Thursday. You know it's the Maze Jackson Social Media Question of the Week, and then you'll catch me with Cliff Kelly. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to break, and when we come back, we'll wrap it up. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM.
You've left me no choice.
All right, y'all. I'm leaving. I need y'all to stick with me. We got a few more minutes. Serious. Roberto, what's up? What up, Rodney? What up? Can y'all take a moment, share the broadcast? Roberto! Great job, man. Thank you for that introduction to Mike, to Michael Romaine. And if you're depressed, how do you get in trouble, bro?
What else am I supposed to do? Remember, when I quit, you quit. Sincerely, your heart.
Listen to your heart. Don't let it quit on you. Doing the minimum to control your high blood pressure isn't doing enough. High blood pressure can lead to a stroke, heart attack, or death. Get your blood pressure to a healthy range before it's too late. Find out how at heart.org/bloodpressure. Check, change, control. A message from the American Heart Association, the American Stroke Association, and the Ad Council.
This is why you work so hard to pay the mortgage. Because home is more than four walls and a roof. It's that porch swing on a summer night. It's pajamas with feet and everybody over for Sunday dinner. And that old stuffed chair in the living room you just can't get rid of. This is why you work a second job. This is why you
learn to fix it. I wanna dance, 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 alright. Home is your place. I wanna dance forever. Okay, let me see who got out there. Sean Thomas, we need more unity and we have to stand together. We'll be more doomed. Yeah, I think we do need to do that, brother. Rodney Alexander. What's in it for the black people, Ron? What's in it for the black people? They did make the laws. What's up, Marlon Watson? Like that profile. Ron Lewis, what's up, brother?
Your 12-year-old self say. Now you want to be a doctor. You don't think teachers save lives? 25 at a time. An actress? Try playing a different role every time the bell rings.
All right, y'all. Get ready. We about to roll up. What's physics? Man. Chemistry?
Who do you think teaches that?
Y'all still out there? Who's still awake with me? If you still awake, give me a thumbs up so I can know you still out there. I'm going to give you a shout out on the air. If you still out there, give me some what's up. Thanks, Dad. I appreciate my shirt. Hey, Dad, check this out. It's got pockets. Ain't that cool? And then it's got a diagonal pocket, too. I think it's slick. You out there? I see y'all showing the boy, showing the brother some love. Let's see who was that. If you out there, let me see. All right, I'm going to need y'all to give me a comment because I can't see the things. I'm sorry. I did appreciate the reactions, but they don't show. Baby bend over, let me see you do the yoga. Baby bend over, baby bend over, baby bend over, let me
do the yoga.
Boom. What's up, Chicago? It's your man, Maze Jackson. We about to close it out. I want to tell y'all, thank y'all for rocking with me. I got to show some love to my Facebook Live family who has been rocking with me all night. Shout out to Still Running Steve All. What's that? Let me do that again. Shout out to Still Running Stovall. Shout out to Marlon Watson. Shout out to Rodney Alexander. Shout out to my beautiful wife, Commissioner Carrie Steele, who is my number one fan, always rocking with me. Ron Lewis, I appreciate you. Tiffany Mojica, thank you, sister. Dad, I always appreciate you, brother. You with me every time, all the time. All right, I'm about to wrap this up. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been an honor to rock with you. I tell y'all all the time, there's nothing I enjoy more than, besides my family, than spending time with the WVON listening audience, sharing this information and this knowledge. Did you have a good time with the show? Did you enjoy the show this evening? I hope you did. I hope you got some information. Did you enjoy our conversation? Now, I'm gonna go back and watch this video because y'all, I'm gonna tell you there was some comedy at the beginning. We were trying to work out some of the technical stuff, so I got to go watch that to see how cool I was not under pressure. You take that, you share that on the Facebook Live video. But did you enjoy Michael Romaine editor of the Village Press. I want to thank Michael Romaine for coming in. You know what? He provided a lot of insight and information. Apparently, maybe a little too much insight and information. Seems like maybe he's been getting some calls and some texts. But here's the thing, ladies and gentlemen. We've got to start holding our elected officials accountable. We cannot be scared to talk to and about the people that represent us when they're doing good and when they are doing bad. $91 million at stake. Our kids' education, future generations. That's what these school board elections are about. You wonder about why we got kids not graduating and not being intelligent. You know, Rodney Alexander pointed out a very good point on Facebook. He said most of the people that were on the school board send their kids to private school. Why does it seem like everybody that's on the school board sends their kid to private school? Do they know something we don't know? That should tell you something. All right. So I want to thank Michael Romaine. I want to encourage you all to go to thevillagepress.org. Check out his information. My sources tell me that that guy is transforming the way politics is viewed in the western suburbs. You know, when the major papers closed down, he decided that it was going to be his labor of love to provide information for the community that he grew up in. So we have to commend him. I'm going to be looking for Michael Romaine to give me some insights for the What's in It for the Black People Voters Guide that will be coming out next week. I'm writing as we speak. In the 10 o'clock hour, we talked to Mr. Rashad Johnson, civil engineer and owner of the Roderick Group, where he brought us up to speed on what is happening with America's infrastructure and how are we going to crack this union stranglehold on all the money that comes down the pipeline when we know that the construction and trade unions aren't necessarily the friends of our community, but they supply our black elected officials. We're going to have to figure out a solution to that. And then, you know, as always, got to stir it up. Sanctuary restaurants. Really, y'all? Sanctuary restaurants? 15% unemployment in the black community. And restaurant owners on the north side have the audacity to say to us, we cannot operate our restaurants without the labor from undocumented aliens. Can I see some certified payrolls there? Can we make sure that those same, since you're so concerned about immigrant rights, can we make sure that the wages and the pay are to scale? See, they be having us say, look over here. So they got y'all all marching to protect immigrant rights so that they can continue to pay substandard wages and then tell you that black people don't really want to work. Yeah, I'm not sure I'm buying that argument. I did ask for someone to come and explain it. They were unavailable this evening, but hopefully we'll get somebody from the Restaurant Association who can explain to us the correlation between the 15% unemployment in the black community. I thought black people used to cook. You know, when they say that the restaurants that they can't operate unless the undocumented immigrants provide you the food. All I'm telling you is, brother and sister, we can do that work. You can tune in tomorrow night, 9 to midnight. It's your man, Maze Jackson. I appreciate you rocking with me. Give us a call, 773-591-1690. Post a Facebook tweet. Share this whole information. And when we come back tomorrow, we'll keep it banging. And until tomorrow, you can tell them, Maze.
Report, shake up at the White House. I'm Elliot Francis. National Security Advisor Michael Flynn has quit his post days after dodging questions about his recorded conversations with Russian officials.
Huh? Just gotta take my phone down. All right, y'all. It's your man Maze Jackson. I'm all sorry me bust my head. Appreciate y'all for tuning in. We on our way out of here.